What's the best thing about being a go-go?
Guzzling.
The raunchy go-go. From rise to demise to resurrection. At first glance, they seem like fresh-faced all-American girls with catchy hooks and killer looks.
All the guys thought they were great, and all the girls wanted to be them.
And in the early 80s, the Go-Go's took the world on a joyous musical ride.
We really captured that moment in time.
But behind the bubbles and bows, the girls hid some dark and dirty secrets.
We were cute and bubbly. I mean, we were also, like, you know, twisted, crazy, drug addict sex fiends.
The band was beleaguered by an insatiable appetite for booze and drugs.
Nothing stopped me, not even going to church.
Physically, I was wrecked, emotionally and spiritually bankrupt. I was in the grips of the devil, you know, that's the way I look at it.
Their friendship was devastated by backstabbing dramas, decadence, and dope.
There were fights, big fights, physical, verbal.
Well, I'm just as good a singer as her, and
oh, it was terrible. A lot of screaming and hollering.
So after just three albums, they decided that five Go-Go's were four too many.
I think in a certain way, they still feel like they blew it.
Now, from rise to demise to resurrection.
We can add something to our legacy. I think we need to.
The Go-Go's, behind the music. In 1985, they were at the top of their game. But the all-girl band that was selling out arenas one week would be history the next.
We always said, if it wasn't fun, we wouldn't do it. And it started becoming really not fun. Then we ended up breaking up.
Amazingly, in May 2000, the Go-Go's were back in the studio. Writing and rehearsing for an upcoming record and tour.
I'm a musical genius!
Clearly, this was no ordinary reunion. This was a musical miracle.
5 years ago, I said I would never, ever, 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 ever do the Go-Go's again.
For 15 years, Kathy, Belinda, Jane, Gina, and Charlotte could barely stand to be in the same room together. But now the 80s new wavers are rediscovering the old magic that once made them superstars.
It's definitely a special energy that we all love when we're together that we have never been able to recreate with anyone else.
When things are good between the girls, they are as close as sisters. A bond they rode to the pinnacle of pop. But that chemistry turned combustible, leading them into a ghastly meltdown of jealousy, anger, and drug abuse that still stings almost two decades later.
It was yucky. It's so sad to think that how great the beginning years were and then how ugly it ended up getting.
The dark days the band has seen are a startling contrast to the sunny early lives of its two founding members. Jane Wiedlin and Belinda Carlisle grew up in L.A. San Fernando Valley. It was a suburban ground zero of barbecues and backyard pools.
I had a pretty idyllic childhood with amazing parents and great brothers and sisters and can't really complain. I mean, I did end up being the total, like, black sheep of my family, but it's, like, through no fault of my parents anyways.
If Jane was the black sheep, Belinda, the oldest of seven kids, was the guinea pig.
I was the one that the experiments were done on. It's being the oldest, I mean, that's your role as guinea pig. So I tried to be as rebellious and as bad as I could, make it as hard as I possibly could for my parents.
On the outside, Belinda seemed the all-American girl, a popular cheerleader who was into the beach and boys. But in 1974, when she turned 16, Belinda's eyes were opened by a punk who was willing to bleed for his art, Iggy Pop. I'm a speedwalking cheater with
a hat full of napalm. It all changed for me when I saw the cover of Raw Power in a record store. I saw a picture of Iggy and I thought, who is this? That album introduced me into a whole other world. The one who searches
and destroys. In the summer of 1976, Belinda left the Burbs for Hollywood's defiant and dirty punk rock scene. There, she met Jane Wheedlin, and together they embraced punk's anarchy and anger.
There was really nothing to be that angry about in the late 70s living in Southern California. I think for a lot of us it was about escapism and having the best time you could possibly have.
For 2 years, the girls' nights were a blur of cocktails and clubs. Then in May of 1978, they decided to start a band.
I think in the beginning it may have just been a fun thing just to be cool and to meet boys and just, you know, be the coolest punks in the scene.
Belinda wanted to sing. Jane opted for guitar. On bass was dyed-in-the-wool punk Margot Olivaria.
I used to have pink and green hair. They used to call me Popsicle Head.
They called themselves the Go-Gos and set their sights on stardom. There was only one problem. They couldn't play a note.
We had to learn how to write songs. Learn about chords, had no idea.
I mean, I didn't even know the name of what I was playing or anything, and you know, or how to tune a guitar. Or nothing. We knew nothing. It was ridiculous.
But punk was less about skill and more about attitude, and the Go-Gos had plenty of that. Within weeks, they booked their first gig at Hollywood's notorious Mask Club.
It was a hellhole, basically. It was in the basement of a porno theater. It was filthy, dirty, and falling apart. And every time they had a show, the toilets would break, and there'd be, like, sewage flooding the place.
Well, we played three songs, second song twice. I remember people either laughing hysterically or just being absolutely mortified.
Somebody wrote that the Go-Gos are to music what botulism is to tuna. And we were really terrible.
But the poisonous press wouldn't stop the girls. In September 1978, they recruited guitarist Charlotte Caffey.
They said, hi, we want to know if you want to join our band. It's called the Go-Gos. And I looked at them, and like right on the spot, I was like, okay.
We sought her out as a sense of security to produce better music because she was a songwriter, and she knew how to turn the knobs on the amps.
But back then, their friendship was as much about sinning as singing. Together, they romped in a place they called Disgraceland, a rundown apartment complex on the seedy side of Hollywood.
It was all, you know, lots of drinking and lots of boys.
They started this whole thing called the Booty Club, and boys were just booty.
So much of what we were doing revolves around boyfriends and getting laid, basically. It's just like such an amazing good time. But I remember all that time thinking, like, if only we could be rock stars, we'll be so happy, everything will be so great.